Today, in Baobab, Redwood and Neem, we talk to one of India's foremost peace educators, Irfan Engineer. Irfan is the director of the Center for Study of Society and Secularism, Mumbai. We discuss what the success of religion-based identity politics in India means for that country, what peace educators around the world can learn from it, and how they can come together to defeat prejudice and move the society towards a more just and happier community. Stay tuned.
We are happy to have you on our show today, Irfan Engineer. Welcome. Election results in India have just come in, and many people are seeing these election results as a failure of secular and democratic forces in the country. Do you see it the same way?
Partly it is true that it is failure of secular and democratic forces to connect with people. But partly there's only so much that secularism and democratic forces could do, given the rise of populism in the world. You know, there's more and more disempowerment of the marginalized. And population seems to them, temporarily at least, a hope that populists will take them out of this mire, that they are the solution. In fact, they are the problem. They present a narrative to bring them out of this pit. They connect with people not on their real issues, but they connect with people on their emotional issues. So the solution that populism offers in general, in the world and as well as in India, is that your religion is important, your nationalism is important. It instills pride and replaces pride with the discourse on rights that they should have. Disempowered and more marginalized people in this context of growing inequality feel that, well, there's no other solution. We may not get bread. Nobody else is offering us bread, jobs, health services, education, and other things that we require. But at least proud about their religion or their nation or their identity. So to this, secular and democratic forces have no immediate solution. And second, I would also attribute to the new avenues available to manufacture consent at a mass level. And that is the social media, which adds to the traditional media, that is print and videos. And the kind of fake news that is generated to bring about polarization. Fear of the other. In US, fear of the migrants and African Americans. In case of Brexit, again, fear of the migrant laborers from other European countries and Asian migrants. In India, they create fear of Muslims, and it is just ridiculous, and people become completely illogical and irrational. Fear is irrational. Once you create that fear through social media and through fake news, and people are scared, then they look for security and strong hero who would deal with the fear, would inflict a blow to the source of the fear.
So do you think that this kind of victory is a temporary victory, and that people will grow tired of populism and start talking of real issues?
It depends on too many factors. One of the factors is what solution that secular and democratic forces have to offer to them, and whether those solutions are attractive, workable, implementable. For example, there was farmers' movement in the country. Farmers mobilized in Delhi for quite long.
Yes.
They were sitting on dharna for over a month.
Yes.
But nobody was listening to them. Except solace, except solidarity, we people could offer nothing to them. They went back to their farms. They wanted solution to their problems, their crisis. And democratic forces had nothing to offer them. If we are unable to offer them anything at all, people will not, think of rights as an abstract solution. But they will, for sure, they will get tired of populism as well, because this is not a real solution at all.
But the people who were protesting against economic injustice, including the farmers, do you think those people voted for the present regime?
Newspaper analysis that we get, they voted, and some of them voted for BJP.
They did. They realized no one's listening. So then they thought might as well vote for somebody who is at least offering glory or pride in my identity. Do you think?
I think that's the, the immediate, immediately before elections, Pulwama happened. And so-called surgical strikes were carried out in Balakot. It is disputable. Citizens of the country were not allowed to ask questions as to where, how, and how many people were killed, who were killed in those surgical strikes. To people it seemed that this is the long-term solution. It gives them pride, and pride seems to be a hope for them to tide over their current situation.
Irfan, when we talk about this politics of identity, not only in India, but as you mentioned earlier, in many other countries around the world, do you think we can link this politics of identity to the failure of neoliberal economic policies?
Absolutely. Because, these neoliberal economic policies are making the world more and more unequal.
Please explain how neoliberal policies, which we can define as policies that reduce government spending, especially in the essential services, and they decrease regulation, or in other words, they make the economy run more by private sector than the public sector. How is that responsible for more inequality?
The whole raison d'etre of capital is to earn more and more profits, even by creating higher inequalities. Even if there are more poor created in the process, so be it. They are not bothered. It is not their business to uplift the poor. Their sole purpose is to privatize profits and put in pockets of only some of them. So, and not care for the people of India. Capitalists do not come into existence to care for people of India, nor for, forget the people of India, not even workers working in the industry. It is not about them. Therefore, the more the privatization, it increases prices of, if healthcare is privatized, prices of healthcare shoots up, more and more people are unable to access healthcare. If agricultural operations operate in such a way to maximize profits, it's more and more peasants will be dispossessed from their land. They will be converted into landless laborers. And how to maximize profit is by technology displacing manual labor. And in India, we have a huge problem of unemployment. India, under this present regime, reached highest unemployment in last 45 years, and that is 6.1% of unemployment. The private capitalists are maximizing their profits by throwing out more and more workers out of job, or casualizing work, contractualizing work, and not creating stable, secure jobs.
This is certainly bringing to mind the definition of fascism that Mussolini gave. He said that fascism should more appropriately be called corporatism, because it is the merger of state and corporate power. And certainly in India, we are seeing that a handful of people, really like a couple of business houses, are controlling everything from groceries to education to health services, and now even military. I mean, it looks like they're manufacturing things for the military. When we talk about private ownership or running of economy by private sector, we are not talking about the small private individuals, the small family-owned businesses that were already present in India. In fact, moves like demonetization have completely destroyed those small family-run or individual-run businesses. We are really talking about the big corporations here who are running the show.
If you see practical behavior of Hindu nationalists, they have always aligned with capitalists and they have always carried out political agenda of free market. They are privatizing all public sector bit by bit, part by part. You know, railway has been privatized. Railway, which is a public sector in India, has been privatized to a large extent by converting everything into contract.
Therefore, it is not surprising that these political leaders get so much funding, insane amounts of money for their political campaigns during elections. It's because they are benefiting the big business houses.
2 years before 2014 general elections in India, which elected populist leader Narendra Modi, all the industrialists had got together on a platform in Ahmedabad, and they declared that Narendra Modi, the then chief minister of Gujarat, is the best prime ministerial candidate that India would have. And then they contributed to the election coffers of BJP in a very big way. Informal estimates of 2014 elections say that BJP spent at least 70,000 crore rupees, and nobody could match them in the funds that they had access to. 70,000 crore rupees is a big number. Modi could, that enabled Narendra Modi to daily go from his residence in Gandhinagar, embark on a private jet after rallies daily, 2 to 3 rallies, come back to his home in Gandhinagar. Again, next day start and on. So they had private jets at their disposal, helicopters at their disposal, all the finances that were required to organize massive rallies, technologies in Project D, images of Prime Minister Modi to remote areas. And you know, this mesmerized people that a candidate who can utilize technology will bring about development in India. Last year, the election funds that were the declared election funds, 95% of the corporate electoral bonds were given to the Bharatiya Janata Party, which is Narendra Modi's party. So all other 50 odd big and small parties put together had only 5% of electoral bonds. So you can imagine the massive funds which were at the end. They were corporate funds, corporate funding elections. So the source of fund is big industrials and the crony capitalists, as I would say.
People on the other side have obviously thought about it a lot. They are using techniques that are succeeding. What does it mean for the peace community?
Can we match resources? We'll never be able to match their resources. But I think once we are able to raise awareness in people successfully, there's a temporary setback. And once energies of 130 crore Indians will match the energy of less than 1% of people or the resources that they have, and nobody can match. I think that the progressive movement has not been able to exploit the icons which fought for Indian freedom, like Mahatma Gandhi, like Dr. Baba Sahib Ambedkar, who was such a proponent for egalitarian society, casteless Indian society. And he rightly focused all his research, activism, and succeeded to a large extent in mobilizing the oppressed Dalits to fight for equality. We had completely ignored Ambedkar to a large extent. You know, our icon was only one from freedom struggle, and that was Bhagat Singh. I think we should have been more inclusive, because more people, more icons means we try to present not only diverse but united India and resources, cultural resources from diverse sources. Maulana Abul Kalam Azad has been largely ignored because, you know, the field of culture was completely ignored by progressive movement. They thought that if we organize the oppressed for their economic demands, that would suffice. Culture, equality in the arena of culture will come automatically. What I see is inequalities in cultural field obstruct the fight for economic justice as well. The pride that I was talking about, that the populace instill pride in the oppressed about their religion, about their race or ethnicity or nationality or their nation, and a false pride. So culture in this case is trumping the struggle for economic justice. What we need to do now is give enough attention to democratization of culture, to reclaim egalitarian culture of the past, which the Sufi saints and Bhakti saints talked about.
This is something that should have been done by the previous governments, especially because they claim that they want a secular India, they want an inclusive India. In all these decades after independence, where they had the opportunity to build a society which is inclusive, which is democratic, and the best way to do it is through education in schools. The education system, if it works properly, will create a society where tolerance, inclusiveness, diversity will be cherished instead of feared.
Our education system is a big failure. A lot of it is based on prejudicial writing of history, you know, prejudicial perspective towards history. And so that is instilled in the children. Very few people can grow out of whatever they were fed during school days or their education days. Very few of them do. Otherwise, you are fed patriarchal, casteist, dominant culture. Even Congress textbooks, role of Muslims was underplayed, role of Dalits and Adivasis were underplayed. Only Congress's role and that of a dominant section within Congress, a few leaders, their roles was focused. Remember, there was nothing much or nothing at all about Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, who was the president of the Congress in 1946 and played a major role in the freedom struggle. We know Muslim participation in freedom struggle only through Jinnah.
And the thing here is that while Hindu Mahasabha and its origins and its role in supporting the British establishment and dividing the Indian population is not given importance, it's not really discussed in the history textbooks, the Muslim League is mentioned, Jinnah is mentioned, and it appears to the reader of these texts as if the Muslim League and Jinnah represented the entire Muslim population, which, as we know in history, is not the case. Most Muslims in India did not support the two-nation theory, just as most Hindus in India did not support the two-nation theory. They believed that they could live together in peace.
Yeah, and also, say for example, how biased these textbooks were. I can give just one example to prove this. When we were told about assassination of Mahatma Gandhi in 1948, hardly any students knew the name of the assassin and the ideology to which that assassin belonged to. That is Nathuram Godse, that he belonged to Hindutva ideology. That the reason why he killed Mahatma Gandhi was the ideological perspective, which was very different from Mahatma Gandhi's perspective, and they wanted to violently eliminate secular nationalism. We were not taught or told this kind of a thing. So it just appeared that some madman killed Mahatma Gandhi.
Similarly, the story of partition in our textbooks is told simply as a story that was a struggle between the Congress and the Muslim League and its leader Jinnah. There is no mention of so many other actors that were playing the game of divide and rule. Unfortunately, from the Muslim community, as you're saying, the only person you hear of is Jinnah.
Now, Pakistan was definitely Jinnah's demand, but the whole context and the complexity and the entire politics surrounding the conflict is not described. For example, the role of Britishers or role of Congress leaders, or what was the nature of conflict about? Was it only religious, or were there economic interests involved? Or
were and also Hindu Mahasabha. The Hindu
Mahasabha and RSS. So the whole story of partition of India is not projected or not described in all its complexities, but simplistically told to us that Jinnah and Muslim League demanded partition and creation of Pakistan, and therefore Pakistan was created on his demand. So it villainizes not only Jinnah, but villainizes the entire Muslim community. And that is what we see that promotes conflict between Hindus and Muslims. And that is why we see even in present, time and again demand is raised that Muslims got their country, Pakistan. And so now they should go and settle in Pakistan. Why are they staying in Hindustan? They were the ones who demanded Pakistan. So why don't they go and reside there?
One of the main reasons why identity politics and sectarianism can succeed in India is this constant tension with Pakistan. It leads to the situation that you've discussed before, where there is fear and there is anger, and both of them are used to justify a strong hero. On both sides of the border, the politicians have kept this issue alive. They have kept the tensions alive. They have not tried to resolve them. At the end of the day, neither the people of Pakistan nor the people of India benefited from partition. Of course, that is history, but we must not repeat it. We must learn from it in the context of the identity politics that is happening in the subcontinent today.
Absolutely, I 100% agree. And even now, it is not too late to understand why the partition took place, what was the trauma about, and how to extend the hand of friendship with people of Pakistan, that how it is necessary, that people of India and people of Pakistan live in peaceful coexistence, except whatever happened in history. Of course, going to the root causes, understand history so that it is not repeated, Even now it is not too late, and it will never be too late. These historical perspectives will get continuously updated, needs to be continuously updated. But it is not only about history. It's about the culture that is transmitted through, even non-historical texts. Mathematics, for example.
So explain that, Irfan, how would maths or English be instrumental in this?
For example, in my childhood, I remember English textbooks from my school. There was a story of a family with Tim and Minnie and their parents. So how they behave, how they play, how they celebrate Diwali, this textbook, which had Tim and Minnie characters and through which they wanted us to learn English, had stereotypical gender stereotypical characters, and not only gender stereotypical but also communally stereotypical characters. So for example, Tim's father goes out to work and earns, and their mother cooks. So a child sees gender roles in his or her family, and then the textbooks describe and reinforce the same gender prejudices that we know. Now, Dalit characters are absent. Muslim character, if Tim has a friend, a Muslim friend, say Abdullah wears a skull cap and wears a typical Muslim dress. Now, this is not how all Muslims are dressed. So the images, the stereotypes are subterraneously reinforced on the minds of the school children once again. So the school child does not see the society in all its diversity. Dalits are absent. Muslim characters and speak Urdu language. They wear typical Muslim clothes. Well, language of Muslims is not Urdu. Urdu is not language of Muslims. Neither all Muslims speak Urdu, nor Urdu is the exclusive language of Muslims in India. But a child who is not traveled throughout India, and child cannot be expected to have traveled throughout India, sitting in the classroom, and the image of Muslim that a child gets, a school-going child gets, is that all Muslims wear skull caps. They speak Urdu. They wear a typical Muslim dress. Muslim women cover themselves with burqa, so on and so forth. They eat mutton. These are the stereotypical images that they get, and so therefore this prejudice is strengthened.
Now that there is an openly and vigorously sectarian government in charge, we cannot expect the education system to get better. The task of peace educators then becomes even more challenging. We'll discuss with Irfan Engineer what can be done and what the institute he's associated with is already doing, the Center for the Study of Society and Secularism in Mumbai. Stay tuned for the next part of this interview. Baobab, Redwood and Neem is an interview series by Peace Vigil. It inspires hope and the will to act on it.
It's the way that we feel. This is life, this is love. It's the notes that we sing. This is life, this is love. It's an every living thing. Oh.